In the summer of 1977, I went on a business trip to New York. On the day I arrived, I went to the theater and bought a ticket for that evening's performance. I went around to the stage door and I asked the guard if I could leave a note for one of the actors. He said yes. I wrote, "Bob, I'm going to be in the audience tonight, and I'd like to come by for a visit after the performance." And I signed it, George McLeod. 17 years earlier, my best friend, Tony Dowell, and I were students at the University of Arkansas at Fayetteville when we signed up for our educational summer abroad. A student tour group organized by a history department professor named Mrs. O'Kelly. It was 4 weeks in Europe with the option to stay and take courses. Our group consisted of 8 girls, Tony and me. This was going to be a long way from Walnut Ridge, Arkansas, our hometown. We all met in New York in early June 1960 and boarded a ship to sail to Naples, Italy, where we would start our land trip. After a day or two on the ship, I noticed that Tony had been talking to a guy that seemed to be hanging around with our group. Tony introduced him to me. His name was Bob. When I asked Bob where he was from, he said, "New York." And when I asked what he did in New York, he said he was an actor. "No kidding," I said, suddenly more interested. "No kidding," he replied. I asked what his travel plans were, and he said that earlier in the spring, he had been in a play in London. When it closed, he had flown back to New York, tried out for a play there, but didn't make the cut. He had left a few belongings in London, and his plan was to start in Italy and slowly make his way across Europe, ultimately returning to London, where he would recover the items he had left there. Well, a guy who said he was an actor and who was going to knock around Europe by himself for the summer was very intriguing to Tony and me. Bob the actor became our new best friend. Right away, Bob expressed an interest in our Arkansas accents. He began to mimic the way we talked. We thought it was funny that he was interested in our southern drawls, so we poured it on more heavily. Tony and I had a greeting we sometimes used. We'd heard it in our rural backgrounds growing up. It went like this. When we met, I would say, "Howdy, Tony, how's your mom and them?" To which Tony would reply, "Well, just doing 100, George, how's yours?" My reply would be, "Well, just fine, come on in, hunker down, and set a spell." Bob loved it. He worked at getting the cadence and the nuance just right. After 7 days, our ship landed in Naples, and our little group of Arkansas travelers went ashore and started our tour. Bob had gotten our itinerary. As we traveled, he would sometimes show up at our hotel. He was traveling on the cheap, staying in youth hostels. So when he appeared, Tony and I would let him take a hot shower in our hotel room. He would hang out with us and usually charm Ms. O'Kelly out of a free meal. He was interesting and fun and certainly different from anyone we knew. We made our way across Europe. We learned a lot. We had fun. Finally, we arrived in London. Our tour broke up there. A few people went to summer school in various places on the continent, and Mrs. O'Kelly returned to the U.S. Tony and I were business majors. You could have expected we might have enrolled for 3 or 6 hours of credit of economics or business at the University of London, but Tony had a better idea. Simply stated, we had had all the economics and business courses we needed to graduate. As business majors, we were never going to get to take a foreign language. Why not go to Paris and study French at the Alliance Française? Sounded good to us. That was our plan. Before leaving London, Bob showed up. He retrieved his things there, and after checking with his agent, he decided he would go to Paris too. In Paris, Tony and I enrolled in the Alliance Française, which taught French to non-French speaking students from all over the world. We went to beginner's classes in the morning and ate lunch in the student cafeteria. After lunch, we would pick out a section of Paris to visit. In the course of 4 weeks, we learned a little French and pretty thoroughly saw all the sights of the city. For a few days, Bob played the part of a student at the Alliance Française. He would meet Tony and me there at noon to have an inexpensive lunch in the student cafeteria. However, rather quickly, the school authorities caught on that Bob was not enrolled and he was no longer able to get in. Shortly after that, Bob appeared one day and said he had received a call from his agent and that he was going back to New York. He left in a day or two, and I thought it was the last I would see of this interesting character. Soon, our educational summer abroad was at an end. We returned to the United States. Tony, who had graduated in June, stayed in New York and entered the Merrill Lynch training program for financial advisors. Carolyn Harris, my sweetheart at the university, had graduated the year before and had taught first graders in Memphis for a year. I returned to Arkansas in mid-August, and we were married in El Dorado on August the 27th, 1960. As Carolyn and I began our married life together in Fayetteville, my trip was fresh in my mind, and I shared with her the fun and adventure of my educational summer abroad. And of course, I told her about the crazy actor we had met. The following spring, we were watching a TV show one night, and there on the screen was Bob. He was playing the part of a deranged criminal. He was good in his part. Over the next year, we began to see him in more TV shows. It was exciting. Then Carolyn and I went to see the great Southern movie classic, To Kill a Mockingbird, starring Gregory Peck. In it is this strange, silently lurking character named Boo Radley. Do you know who played Boo Radley? It was my friend Bob. Now do you know who Bob is? He's an Academy Award winning actor, Robert Duvall. I returned that night in New York to the theater to see the play. Before entering, I stopped at the stage door and asked the guard if he had given my note to Mr. Duvall. He said yes, he had, and Mr. Duvall had said he would see me after the performance. When the play was over, I went to the stage door. The guard greeted me and said, "Mr. Duvall is in his dressing room at the end of the hall." The door of his dressing room was open, and Bob was sitting on the edge of the bed. He looked up and saw me coming. Can you guess what he said after all these years? With a perfect Southern accent. "Howdy, George, how's your mama and them?" "Come on in and hunker down and set a spell." And we did.